let me just quickly start by, you know, thanking, actually congratulating IDG for a phenomenal journey. I think I've been pretty much part of 8 years out of these 10 years with IDG. I think first check that Sudhir wrote for us was 2008. And I think we've been through, like, you know, some of the other entrepreneurs mentioned, lots of ups and downs together, but it's been a very rewarding journey. So Sudhir, TCM, Ranjit, congratulations, well-deserved, and wish you all the best for next 10 years. I guess the lot of theme today was about looking back at last 10 years and looking ahead for next 10 years. So Sudhir asked me, you know, talk about my take on entrepreneurship for 10 years. So I want to start with a disclaimer, you know, the famous saying by Yogi Berra, right? You know, it's difficult to make predictions, especially about future. So with that caveat, you know, I think, you know, most of us are not even able to predict our numbers for next quarter. So it's very tough to talk about what's going to happen in entrepreneurship for 10 years. But let me start by just, you know, again, looking back in last 10 years and see how we can extrapolate things from here. So, you know, Myntra was officially founded in 2007, but we started thinking about it in 2006. It's almost 10 years. And if you look at, you know, in entrepreneurship, we talk about 0 to 1, right? So in some way, 0 to 1 has happened for the entrepreneurial ecosystem. I think in 2006-07, there absolutely nothing. You know, there were no funds, no entrepreneurs, no internet, no market, absolutely nothing, right? So it was blank canvas. So in those days, you know, whoever decided to either start a company or think of starting a business, I think the thesis was India is a large country. You know, technology is a technology, internet, sooner or later will have a huge impact. There's a lot of growth that's ahead of for the country. So putting all together, you know, people could not predict when, but it was easy to say, like, sooner or later things will add up and it will add up to a big market, right? So it's because of, you know, some of the, you know, people who started at that time. Now the ecosystem is very mature and thriving. I think, you know, number of entrepreneurs who are coming in to start new companies, number of VC funds who have set shop, and you know, to think of many of them are onto their third and fourth fund. It's a huge progress. You know, internet obviously has grown massively, and with today's Jio announcement, I think it's ready for another, you know, massive boost over the next 6 to 12 months. So we've come a long way in terms of, you know, setting the ecosystem. One thing we have to understand, you know, Sudhir mentioned that, you know, he was one of the first one to do a 10-year fund. If you look at you know, building companies, building ecosystems, these are multi-decade processes. It can't be short-circuited. You know, I think all of us look up to Silicon Valley as an example, but Silicon Valley has been in the making, you know, for last at least 40 years, if not more, if you go back to all the way to HP, right? You know, from Xerox PARC to PCs in the 70s to, you know, you guys all know the history, right? So in some ways, you know, we have just crossed stage one of ecosystem development in India. I think next 10 years is also going to be about continue to build that ecosystem. For entrepreneurship to play a significant role in India, it can only happen if the ecosystem is that mature. So what are all the different components of the ecosystem, right? It's, I think entrepreneurs are, I think everyone has acknowledged, is a very core part of the engine, but to be an entrepreneur, the environment also has to be such that, you know, people are inspired and willing to take their risk. To some extent, you know, that has happened. You know, we have now have some, you know, phenomenal successes. A lot of, you know, younger kids are inspired. You know, they look after these companies and they want to follow on their footsteps. So just the top of the funnel is increasing in terms of people who want to take on entrepreneurship. It's also important to see, like, companies, you know, that these folks have built, they are built to last, and they eventually, you know, get to profitability, sustainability, dominate their respective markets. That's work in progress. I think, you know, there are good successes, but not necessarily, you know, we have companies which are you know, generating meaningful, sustainable cash flow. So that's yet to happen. I think so far collaboration with the government has been quite on the, you know, lower side. It's only now, I think last 2-3 years, the government is also waking up the fact that entrepreneurship can play a meaningful role. I think so as part of, you know, next stage of ecosystem development, that's need to happen a lot more. I think the Startup India was a great initiative. I think, you know, more such things will happen. That's a kind of important part. Just quickly talking about what role entrepreneurship will play in the development of India. So if we, you know, if look back and think of next 10 years, you know, I think the big overarching thought for me is, you know, it's very simple. you know, compounding calculation, if you do, you know, Indian economy is about $2.2-2.3 trillion today, still growing at 7-8% year over year, and there is no slowing down. So with that kind of growth over 10 years, you know, it's Indian economy become $5 trillion. That's a $2.5 trillion worth of valuation that, you know, the our GDP rather, so, you know, will get created over the next 10 years. So where will all of that come from? You know, it can't possibly be that all of that growth is coming from public sector companies growing to that level or some of the large family companies, right? I think a lot of this will happen through entrepreneurship. So for India to realize these numbers and to see this kind of growth, you know, it has to be on the back of very robust entrepreneurship. And all the signs are that, you know, we are moving in that direction. We have covered a lot of ground last 10 years. And if we continue this pace, continue to build the ecosystem, it's a very high likelihood that a big portion of that growth will come, you know, driven by a lot of entrepreneurs that today probably most of us not even heard of, right? They're probably toiling away in a garage or may start next year or year after. The other big, you know, role that, you know, in all of the entrepreneurship, it's the role of technology. You know, technology is a great lever, right? It doesn't require huge amount of capex. Whatever you build, you know, can be deployed all across, you know, India, accessible by over 1 billion people immediately. So, you know, most of what will happen in the next, you know, 10 years will be driven by technology. But the question comes, you know, what kind of technology? If you, you know, one of the critique of, let's say, companies that are built in last, you know, 7-8 years, a lot of them are copycat models, you know, models that have been proven elsewhere, and a lot of entrepreneurs, Mintra included, you know, we said, okay, this, you know, thing works in US or Europe, you know, why not India? You know, people, consumers are same, they want thing, you know, so we started building those companies. Can that model continue in future? I think it's difficult, and we are also seeing that, right? You know, if, you know, someone is doing something for, you know, a decade or two, and you, even if you start, there's nobody, but sooner or later, you know, India is, as Sudhir said, you know, the probably one of the largest untapped market in the world. So it's going to be on everyone's radar, which means sooner or later, if you prove the market is big, the best in the world will come here and will come here, you know, very hard. So what this means that the companies of future who need to win anything in India, they need to be competitive at global scale. That's the only way to win. You know, unlike China, we don't have too much regulatory protection, so we can't, you know, count on 5 to 7 years of no one, you know, being able to enter that market, right? You know, one of the, I think, you know, things we talk about, you know, if you're Google of China is Baidu, but Google of India is Google, right? Facebook of China is Tencent and WeChat, but Facebook of India is Facebook, right? And so on, right? You know, look at all big technology industries. So which means, you know, it's both good and bad. So Indian entrepreneurs will not have the kind of prediction that a lot of Chinese technology companies have enjoyed. But we have, you know, a huge country, a lot of unsolved problems, a lot of development ahead of us. You know, technology is accessible to everyone. So this will, in the long term, make Indian entrepreneurs really, really strong because we'll have to compete with the best in the world. So one of the imperative for anyone, you know, who's looking to start a company over next, you know, or 5 to 10 years is, can we build something which will be competitive at global stage? That, you know, can we look at, you know, where the world is moving, not where India is moving, not what is the delta between what US has and what India has, but what is next for the world, right? You know, whether it's, if it is driverless cars, you know, what does that mean for India? You know, we can't wait for someone to build out driverless cars, you know, operating system, commoditize, build it in US and China, and then say now it's proven. That's just absolutely not happening. By the time that happens, you know, that company will realize India is also a big untapped market, let's come here. So it's, I think that's going to be the big defining change between next 10 years and last 10 years. You know, it's a genuinely innovative business models and technology which are very competitive at global scale. So 10 years from now, when we're celebrating, you know, 20th anniversary of IDG and looking at the successful portfolio companies, I think we'll also be able to say those companies were competitive. They are best in the world. If they're number one in India, there's high likelihood, you know, they are very, very good in that. It there, so that that puts, you know, a lot more, I guess it underscores the need for Indian companies to be truly technology-driven company. Now, that's where, you know, another part of the ecosystem comes into play. Like, the reason Valley is successful there is the technology ecosystem is very, very strong. You know, every, you know, if you look at a typical technology company, you know, from engineers to product managers to UI designers, all the frameworks you need, you know, all of those have been getting iterated again and again and again. If you look at each of those parts slowly, you know, engineers, the big difference between, you know, the engineering culture in Valley and India is, you know, after 3-4 engineers, you know, most of the folks from engineering, they want to graduate to be a tech lead and engineering managers and a span of control of 20-30 people. And before you know it, you know, you can't code. You are a little bit removed from the action. In Valley, there are a lot of engineers who've been coding for the last 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. You know, those of you who have looked into talent code or whole 10,000 hour rule, it applies to programming as much. You know, how can somebody who's programmed only 3 years of his life compete with someone who's been programming for the last 15, 20 years? You know, one of the startup I used to work in Valley, you know, I think the CTO there was this guy called Frank. And after some funding, they hired 3-4 engineers, but this guy just won't let code anyone. And even someone will check in, you know, he will check out their code and review every single line and check it back in, you know, overnight with comments. How many CTOs, you know, India can do that? And this guy was, you know, this was in late 90s, and he was one of the early employees at Microsoft. So he's been programming for 20 years, and I'm sure still programming, you know, to this day. So the quality of engineers, right? I think we need to develop that ecosystem. Now, for Indian companies to be able to build that, the kind of technology that's a competitive global scale. You know, product managers, I think most of you who tried to build a tech company in India would have struggled with the, you know, how do we hire product managers? Product management is, you know, it is a bit of an apprenticeship model where, you know, in Google, you know, the APM program is a very good example, right? You know, you as a junior product manager, you get to work with more senior product managers, you shadow them, you go through a lot of product iterations, you are able to do your A/B testing on the side. You just get continuous feedback, and oh, after 4, 5, 7 years of practice, you become a good product manager. You know, India, that's just barely starting to happen. Now you can find, you know, folks with maybe 2, 3, 4 years of product management experience, and there are very few people who have moved back from Bay Area, but we will need, you know, stellar world-class product managers to do that. Again, very, very important thing, in all consumer-facing companies have phenomenal user interaction. And user interaction is, you know, it's a very good blend of art and science. It's, you know, there's all kind of, you know, A/B testing you can do, and but also intuitive feel for, you know, from aesthetic point of view, understand your market, understand consumers. You know, we haven't had, you know, there's, again, huge shortage of really good user experience designers and visual designers. So I think these are all the things that, you know, whole ecosystem needs to invest in, nurture, grow, and only when we have critical mass of all this, then the entrepreneurs can hope to assemble really good teams, build technology that can be competitive at a global stage. And you know, if we are not able to do that, then, you know, industry after industry will say somebody, you know, a big, large global players comes to India, and then all the, you know, Indian company starts, you know, struggling for survival. So if technology is going to play a very big role, you know, what are the big technology trends that, so this is, you know, very speculative, but this is my take on which technologies I think will play a big role over next, you know, 10 years. So one is, I'm pretty sure, I think we can't get enough of all the, what AI is going to do and all of that. But, you know, despite all the hype, the reality is that it's very, very serious. So I'm from, you know, computer science background, and in CS, since 50s, people have been talking about AI, and there is this whole thing about, you know, there will be 10 years of hype in artificial intelligence, and there will be, you know, 10 years of winter, because after 10 years of effort, people will give up, right? So 50s and 70s and 90s. And then again, you know, when all this hype started 5, 6 years ago, for a lot of people, it seemed like it's just another cycle, you know, where, but this time, I think because of number of reasons, you know, because how, the compute power, you know, has become really, really cheap. That data has really exploded. So internet and mobile phones have, you know, very cheap storage, compute, and internet, mobile phone all put together have just, you know, exponentially increased the amount of data available. So people are finally able to write algorithms which can crunch huge amount of data. They have all kind of compute power available on demand. So, and then AI is starting to become very real. And the moment, you know, I think if the algorithms you are writing, if they can fundamentally keep getting smarter and learning, I think that, you know, completely changes the ball game. It's a there is no industry, you know, which will not get touched by AI. In fact, most industry will probably not exist, you know, without AI. And, you know, all the examples are right, you know, around us. Just, I think in the last couple of weeks, there are reports in Singapore already one company is started in a pilot phase, driverless cars. I think I'm forgetting Tesla or Uber is planning a pilot next month in Pittsburgh to test the driverless. This is now in 2-3 years from now. I think some Western market, it will be pretty common. Maybe, you know, India takes slightly longer or not, I don't know. But you know, from there to, you just name your industry, I think everywhere AI will have a huge role to play, right? You know, from health to education to, you know, every industry. But AI is, you know, unlike the technologies of the past, it's also pretty deep to be able to really be meaningful. You know, there's a lot of serious math, there's a lot of computer science, and without the teams really understanding it, you know, AI is not going to be very commodity technology where you just, you know, hire something from Google or AWS and build on top of that, because you have to go much deeper and come with innovative algorithms. But that's, you know, one technology that will have a huge impact on, you know, kind of all industries. And the very interesting one, which actually I didn't recognize, but I'm just starting, I'm seeing that, is the impact on manufacturing. And that's also pretty much driven by AI and robotics. See, last 2-3 decades, the trend was because of low cost of labor, you know, all the manufacturing will keep moving from US to China. But if AI is going to become so intelligent and we're going to have huge automation in factories and robots can do all the work, you know, the only ingredients you need is your design knowledge, you need raw materials, which cost same around the world, and you need energy, which thanks to solar power, et cetera, will become cheaper and cheaper. Then, you know, what role does labor play in that? So I think there is a massive shift in manufacturing that's kind of looming large. It's labor will increasingly play less and less role, and therefore the whole shift from West to China or India may stop, and the manufacturing of future may have way more automation, and the labor cost will be a lot lower. And that's potentially, you know, one trend. And so India, we have, I guess, struggled as an economy because of not having very strong manufacturing. But every time the rules of the games change, that throws a very new opportunity. You know, all the problems of the past stops mattering. I think this is a pretty exciting change that's happening, you know, starting to happen, and likely to play important role in some, you know, the trends over next 10 years. And good thing, I guess, in India is we do need, despite, you know, all the IT technology, internet revolution, you know, at the end of the day, people live in real physical world. People consume physical things. They need to be produced somewhere. And anything produced locally is cheaper, faster, more nimble. So I think there's a lot of interesting opportunities on that space. Third trend, and which kind of briefly actually mentioned, is what's happening in the whole energy space. It's quite likely in the next 10 to 20 years, you know, energy will become significantly cheaper and exponentially cheaper than what it is now with all the stuff that's happening. I think solar is starting to, you know, get the benefit of Moore's law. The cost, you know, the technology is becoming quite mature, scalable, cheaper. And when energy becomes very cheap, again, you know, a lot of establishment will get threatened in many different ways, because, you know, that's energy is the fuel that powers almost everything that moves. And if energy becomes dramatically cheaper or maybe even free, you know, so that's one area I think would likely to see a lot of innovation. Other thing in the Indian context is, you know, is a little bit relevant to also what we are trying to do is health, right? So there is a dramatic difference in quality of healthcare in India and in the Western world. Like and maybe, you know, to explain that, you know, there are, you know, Ankit also in the audience and my co-founder, you know, we keep thinking about, you know, just trying to understand India. In our mind, we come up with, you know, there is, you know, we used to talk about two India, but there are probably three India. There's one India of, you know, about 20 million people. These are people like, you know, you and I, you know, we have pretty decent income, access to, you know, we can have this conversation, access to world knowledge, information. We, you know, we can fit in very easily, whether it's in New York or London or Bay Area, you know, no one can tell the difference. We talk the same language, consume same products. But there are very few, less than 1% or 1 to 2% of India is that. Most of, you know, market that brands target is these consumers. Even e-commerce till date, you know, is primarily driven by this segment. These guys live in big cities. In fact, they live in small pockets in big cities, you know, your Indiranagars and Kormangla and Jubilee Hills and Bandra and, you know, South Extension, so on, just very few pockets. Then there's second India of about 150 to 200 million people who are the kind of true middle class, and they also drive a lot of consumption and any product. So those guys are mostly serviced by your big FMCG companies. Then there is another billion plus people, and who serves them? Basically nobody. Right, that whole of India is ignored. So everyone talk about India being, you know, huge country, 1.3 billion people, big market. So today, almost no one is building any solution for that. No one, you know, even understands, you know, what those, who those people are, where do they live, what their challenges are, what is their disposable income, which is very, very tiny, continues to be very tiny. So coming back to, you know, why I'm talking about this, right? So if you look at healthcare, so this 20 million people, they have access to best healthcare in the world. You know, at you will have best doctors at your beck and call. The next 150 to 20 million, acceptable healthcare. You know, there is a reasonable, organized healthcare. But next billion people, they have only access to all these quacks on some very shabbily run government hospitals, if that. You know, same situation in education. You take any of the, you know, things we take for, you know, consumption things we take for granted, those guys don't have access to that. So I guess a big question for India and entrepreneurship is, can we develop in products and services for which can leapfrog market one and market two and eventually touch market three? I think if we don't do that, will the gap between these two will, you know, the whole trickle down thing, you know, it happens, but slowly or long period of time, definitely not fast enough. But despite the trickle down, the gap keeps increasing. So that's, you know, very interesting challenge for India, you know, who and how and when we develop solution for that. No country can be a developed country if, you know, over a billion people are living at a life standard which, you know, world has moved on a long time ago. And today, you know, and there is not a whole lot is happening in India to solve that, you know. So taking every consumption sector and figuring out solutions which can potentially be applicable to all of India. Now there are a lot of constraints, you know, what role, it's a, you know, something may require human or physical infrastructure. You know, who builds the physical infrastructure? Is there a way to completely leapfrog physical infrastructure and completely digitize that? Like, you know, again, education and health are two examples where, theoretically speaking, you don't need a whole lot of physical infrastructure. We can do a lot of that just through digitally. So I think, so we are at, you know, interesting juncture. Just to summarize, I think we had a good one decade of, you know, entrepreneurial venture ecosystem developing, but still probably two decades away from full maturation and being competitive. You know, China, on the same scale, probably had two decades. You know, so Alibaba started in mid-90s, and Tencent also started late 90s, Baidu started late 90s. So China is probably a decade ahead in terms of the whole ecosystem. For us to, you know, build big technology-driven companies, we need to be competitive at global scale. Otherwise, it'll be very difficult for Indian companies to be long-term sustainable. India's massive number of problems to solve, you know, huge number of problems who are still relatively untouched with all the progress, you know, people, but they're reachable, and that's a phenomenal, you know, good news. So they are not inaccessible anymore, and that is probably the biggest change between now and 5 years ago. You know, all these billion people I talked about, almost all of them have a mobile phone, and increasingly a smartphone. So they, you know, people can reach them, especially if it's a digital goods, products, services. So I guess the both the opportunity and challenge for entrepreneurs in the next decade is, you know, how do we look at all of this, put it together, and build a solution that has a massive social impact, massive impact on in the growth of India, which will translate, you know, $2.5 trillion of new GDP that will get created. And in some ways, you know, entrepreneurs also then, you know, play a role in being part of, you know, getting India to really matter at the global stage. So it's, I guess, you know, very exciting time. You know, as an entrepreneur, I feel very privileged to be part of this journey. It's, you know, it's been a phenomenal learning experience. I'm very excited and optimistic about, you know, the role that entrepreneurship will play in future. And I look forward to celebrating, you know, another 10 years with the IDG team, you know, in 2026. Thank you.